Okay, this lecture it will be a very interesting lecture, but you will have to listen the whole hour to understand it. It's called Email from God. I made that lecture a few years ago, and I got huge response on it, because it's very good. So we'll do it again today. And I'm going to, most of it will be reading, but I want you to listen to what I say, okay? Shh. No noise, please. Many years, I tried to imagine to myself, what would be if I can get an email from God? One time I found a website called The Gate of Heaven. Accepting emails and forwarding it to God. I couldn't think about anything else. After a few days of dilemma, should I send, should I not send? I decided to create contact with the creator of the world, with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. No text, please. No, put it off. And trying to send email to God looked to me more or less about trying to send a signal to Mars, to Neptune, to a different star, maybe looking for some aliens. But you know, I said to myself, what do I have to lose? Worst comes to worst, nothing will happen. If you could send an email to God, what would you ask? What would you write in the email? Today people do it manually. They go to the Kotel, to the Western Wall, they put a note, and every once in a while they clean all the notes there and make rooms for new notes. That's how it is today. Yeah, but today we are in a very modern world, so we can send an electronic email to Hashem. So how would you do it? What would you write? I've been thinking about it for hours, and this is what I wrote. Listen, it's going to become very interesting. You have to listen to every word. Dear God, as you know, I'm a Jew, Yerei Shamayim. You know, I fear you, I respect you, I keep your mitzvot. I follow every halacha in Shulchan Aruch. But I feel some kind of emptiness in my life. I keep Shabbos, I put tefillin, I learn Torah every day. But still, my life is too boring. I need to do something more exciting with my life. My hope is that you really give me some kind of a test like you gave Avraham Avinu. Like the Akedah, that he took his son Yitzchak. Or something that will excite my life in such a way that I feel challenged. That will revive my whole Torah and mitzvot. I'm going to feel alive by keeping the mitzvot. One of the things when I used to be a kid, I was hallucinating that maybe an angel came from heaven and gave me a mission to save the world. Now you are the messenger of God, and from now on you're going to get instructions and you're going to save the world. But it never happened in reality. Now when I have this opportunity to send you an email, maybe you can reply to my email even without clear miracles. I would really appreciate a response from you. That's the first email he sent. Your servant, Mr. Plony. I pressed send, the email disappeared, and I knew that now I have to wait and see if I get a reply or not. I was very excited. I was full of hopes, hoping to get an answer. Every hour I checked my emails. Before I went to sleep, I checked again. It took me an hour to fall asleep, thinking, why didn't I get an email back yet? Until I was falling asleep. In the middle of the night, I was getting up, thinking maybe something happened. Run, turn my laptop on, my computer, checking my emails, nothing yet. My hands were shaking, maybe now, and it still wasn't coming. One day, I saw an email from the website Gate of Heaven. That's where I sent this first email. My hands started to shake. My heart was pounding. I tried to balance the mouse in the right box. And I knew right away, before I even opened that email, that this email is going to change my life. Quickly, when I opened it up, I started to read, and I felt major disappointment. Completely the opposite of what I expected. This is the email God sent me. Chazor betshuva al avera achat shel lashon hara. לקבלת עזרה ומידע נוסף, תוכל לפנות אל מסוף המידע שלנו, www.shaarei-shamayim. Translation, make tshuva, repentance from one sin of lashon hara, of gossip. For help, please ask for more help in our website, www.gateofheaven.lashonhara.database. That's the email. After what I request, this is what God told me, to make tshuva on one lashonhara that I spoke. One little tiny sin. What a disappointment. I was expecting maybe Hashem will give me some kind of an adventure, a message, being a messenger. Go to the Himalaya, go to Zimbabwe, go to Brazil, gather a million people, something. After all, God sent me that email. And in the bottom of the email, there was a connection to this Lashon Hara website. I pressed on the link, and I saw a list of Lashon Hara that I spoke in my life. That day, that date, you spoke to Rivka, 1 hour Lashon Hara about that person. They show me the whole conversation. Click to the next one. That day you spoke to Yitzchak, 10 minutes, Lashon Hara about that person. They show me the whole dialogue. I got shocked to find out that I have 50,000 emails in my file of different Lashon Hara conversations that I spoke about people in my past. 50,000 emails. Each one I was opening, it's a whole conversation about one person, about this, about that. I froze. So much Lashon Hara, it's more than 5 incidents a day, in average. In the last 30 years, I'm 43 years old. Since it's Bar Mitzvah. What's before is not registered. The list begins from Bar Mitzvah. Even though I was trying to keep all the Torah, I'm a religious person. How can it be that I gather so much? So I said, well, after all, I have to pick up one of them. So I clicked on one of them. Let's correct that. March 16, 1998. The victim, who is the victim? Chaim Blank, that's his name. An accountant. The damage, ruining his professional reputation. Spoke about his, one of his accountants in 1996, that he didn't do a good job, whatever. And
so
1998, I'm sorry, you're right. March 16th, dude, you're paying attention, it's good. Very good. I didn't remember what I spoke about this Chaim. So I clicked, double clicked, and I was staring on the stage, and I saw a video of what I spoke. They just showed me a video, not only a list. Chaim Blank was a very good friend of mine. He's a professional accountant, but is not so successful financially. He has very difficult time supporting his family. That year, I wanted to help Chaim, so I hired him to make my annual tax return. When Chaim gave me the list, the return, I got very angry that according to his calculation, I owe $5,500 to the IRS. I got so angry that I called my friend Shimon, that was about to hire Chaim tomorrow to prepare his tax return, and I told him, this guy has no idea what he's doing. Instead of getting me refund, he found that I have to pay $5,500 to the IRS. That's the video. Now it says to make tshuva for that sin, click here. So I clicked. I saw it's not so simple. This is what came out. Pay attention because you're going to get the shock of your life. Finally, for the first time, we're going to understand what does it mean to speak Lashon Hara. Without this, nobody understands. This is a genius, whoever wrote it. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam shehakol nehiyah bidvaro.
Amen.
Provision one. If the Lashon Hara did not make any damage to the person you spoke about, this is a sin between you and God directly. The way to erase that sin is to make tshuba, to repent, to regret, to make vidui every day, chatati, aviti, pashati, dibarnu lashon hara, to accept never to repeat that sin ever again. Then one day Hashem accepted and the sin is taken out of the file. Two, if the Lashon Hara made a damage to the person, this is a double sin. Sin between you and God, as we just explained how to make tshuva for it, and a sin between you and a friend, ben Adam lechavero, between one Jew to another. A sin between a person to another person is not erased until it's fully corrected. To make tshuva, repentance, for that kind of sin, you have to do five things. A, to apologize to the person and ask him to forgive you and accept his apology. You cannot accept it, you have a big problem. To convince all the people who heard bad things from you about him that it's not correct and you misled them and you gave them the wrong information, please to forget everything they heard from you about that individual. That's number two. No. Right away, I realized after reading those two that I caused him a financial damage. Why? Because this guy was about to hire him the next day. So right away, it's whatever he was supposed to make. And obviously, it's a sin between me and God and a sin between me and Chaim. Since I had two ways, I didn't know how am I going to ask Chaim to forgive me after a few years that it happens. Since he's a good friend of mine, I was very embarrassed to tell him that I'm the one who ruined his reputation. To come tell someone that you spoke Lashon Hara about him is not so simple. But I knew there is no way to correct it otherwise. Then I remember that the email from God told me that in case I need help, they have in their website, Gate of Heaven, instructions. I checked the toolbar and it says, please go and check the chain reaction of your Lashon Hara. To check the chain reaction of your Lashon Hara, click here. I click the link and I saw hundreds of errors from one person to another. Shimon to Yosef, Yosef to Levi, Levi to Yaakov, Yaakov to five people. Errors all over. Spreads like cancer. Thousands of people already are involved against this Chaim, the accountant. It's like a tree. Full of branches and leaves. Raphael, Moti, Avigail, Yosef, Levi, Yitzchak. Thousands of names. I saw my words, how they travel to people I don't know who they are. I got shocked. I say my Lashon Hara has continued to grow as we speak. I clicked again, I was already new names. I went out, I clicked again, also new names. It's growing so fast. This is months or years after, it continued to, the damage continued to grow. Everyone wants to hire him. Somebody already remembered that he's not good. For 1-2 minutes that I spoke against him, this is how he continued. 189 people so far already are passing it to other people, active. Not only hearing, active. I was very embarrassed. How can I correct this now? How will I get these 189 people? I don't even know who they are. There's no way to start. No, so what are we going to do? I remember a story that I heard when I was a kid many years ago. A person that his name is Yankel, that he used to repeat every gossip that he hears in every chance that he has to others. When he matured, he realized that one day he's going to stand in a court of law in front of God, and he will show him all the gossip that he was talking. So he wanted to correct it. So he went to the chief rabbi of his city. He told him, show me how to make tshuva and kapara, to repent for all the gossip that I spread in my life. No problem, the rabbi say. Take a pillow full of feathers. Go to the roof of your building, of the highest building in town. Hit the blanket with all your strength. Yaakov say, what's the point, rabbi? All the feathers will fly away. He said, this is what you have to do. But I didn't understand how I'm going to erase my sin by hitting a pillow in the roof of the building. So I went up all the way to the building, because this is what the rabbis say, and you have to listen to the rabbis. I went up, and I said, if that's what the rabbis say, it's very easy. It's much easier than what I thought, Yankel thought. Right there, he went to the highest building in town, and he hit with a stick, the pillow, 1, 2, 5, 10, the pillow got ripped, and thousands of feathers were flying all over. He ran quickly to the rabbi to say that mission were complete. Rabbi, I did exactly what you told me. Am I dismissed from all my gossip? The rabbi says, go collect all of them right now. So how can I collect them? They're flying all over. He said, this is the way to correct your Lashon Hara. So I remember that I'm in the same situation, this guy says. He said, you know what? Yankel didn't have email, but I have. Why don't I send 189 emails right away to these people on the list and beg them that it's all a mistake not to continue to transfer? And then in 1 minute I can get to all of them. No, good idea, no? Quickly I collected all the emails. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what I wrote. You may not know me, and I apologize if I invaded your privacy. I'm referring to you in this way to pass a very important message to you today. I spoke against Chaim Blank in the ears of few people. As an accountant, things went out of control. People took things out of their content, and they arrived to your ears. And I want you to know that everything that you heard is 100% not true. Please do not hesitate to use him. He's a professional accountant and do his job in the most professional way. No? I sent the email to 189 people and I breathed. I was very proud of myself. With the help of technology, maybe I finally will correct my file and get rid of that sin. That's what God sent me, no? I felt very relieved, but the relief did not take long. 10 minutes later, I started to get responses from my email, from all my new friends. This is what they wrote to me. How did you get my email? Please remove it from your evil list. Don't ever disturb me again. I'll make a complaint against you. I don't believe your recommendation. There's no smoke without fire. I believe the first initial Lashon Hara that you spoke about them, that's the truth, not what you're saying now. We received your information, sir. You have no idea what you talk about. Other people also complaining about him. In the end, I realized that not only I failed in my mission, people already made up their mind. There's no way to convince them to change. There's no way to change the reputation of Chaim Blank. I felt that there's no other choice. What am I going to do? I'm going to have to beg him for forgiveness. But then I started to think how exactly I will present it to him, knowing that I'm the one who stuck the knife in his back in the ears of 189 people. Maybe I will only make things worse. So far he is not aware of it. When he finds out that the only reason that he's poor is me, maybe he gets even more upset. And I started to think, some of the rabbis say that you have to say, and some say it's better not to say, because you add more to his suffering. Chafetz Chaim, which is an expert in Lashon Hara, he said that you have to tell the person the Lashon Hara that you spoke about it, and it's a part of your repentance. Shmirat HaLashon, chapter 4, provision 12. But Rav Yisrael Misalanter, which was a giant also, said that that's going to cause him more pain, and it's not permitted. Contradiction between two giants. Which one of the two? So, obviously, maybe I will go with the one that is easier for me, not to embarrass myself. I send another email. Dear God, am I allowed to tell Chaim that I'm the one who ruined his reputation? Should I go like Chafetz Chaim, or should I go like Rav Yisrael from Salant? No. The email that God responded to me is, you don't get answer from heaven about your question in Halacha. You get them from the rabbis. Please go to your personal rabbi for advice. That's what the autistic kid told me 10 years ago. I asked him, he said, I'm not a rabbi. This is a question for a rabbi.
Who said it to
you? An autistic kid. If Eliyahu HaNavi come and answer Halacha, we don't listen to him. Why? Torah is not b'shamayim. Ay. No, it's only beginning. Wait and see where we're going now. I called the rabbi and asked him my question. The rabbi said, in one hand, Chafetz Chaim is an expert in Lashon Hara, and everything we do in Lashon Hara, we follow him. And he's the one who brought it to the awareness of the people, and it's very difficult to rule against his opinion. But on the other hand, Rav Yisrael from Salant was the founder of the movement of the Musar and ethics, and is a giant in his level, and we cannot ignore his opinion. Who am I to rule between those two giants? I am a midget compared to them, the rabbi sent him. Therefore, I cannot rule like any one of them. It's a contradiction. Mi ani she'achnis et roshim ben shnei harim. You want me to tell you which one of the two is right? It's too much for me. Now I'm more confused, he says. God doesn't answer me. The rabbi cannot rule. I say, you know what? I cannot take a risk. I have to go and knock on the door of Chaim Blank. Even though I didn't know what to say, I decided first to go. Gently, being diplomatic, politically correct, I went and wanted to say something in a way that he won't really get offended. Chaim, I got something to tell you. I started to mumble. I'm stuttering. I got something to tell you. I have to tell you, I mean, but I don't really know how to tell you. Sometimes things, it's not the case. You know, we always been great friends. Maybe I should say it other different way. Chaim looks at me. very surprised. He said, "Ma, why don't you organize your thoughts first and then tell me what you really want to say? You know, I'm very happy you came, Chaim say. You know how horrible I'm doing in these days? I cannot finish the month. I don't know what's going on. I have such a curse in my life. No customers calling me. Everyone who was in touch with me in the last minute changed his mind. Maybe, since you're a good friend of mine, maybe you can do a favor to me," Chaim says to him. "You've always been a great friend, and I know I can count on you. Can you lend me $5,000 for a few months?" "Sure, Chaim! Of course! My pleasure to help you." "Oh, Chaim," say, "I know that you're a great guy. I wish everyone would be sincere like you." And I felt like such a hypocrite. So plan B also went down the tube. I came to tell him what I did. After all the compliments he gave me, how will I open my mouth? I can never tell him what a hypocrite I am. Now I'm really in trouble. How am I going to be able to fulfill the mission that God sent me in the email to erase one problem of Lashon Hara? I never knew it's going to be so difficult to correct one Lashon Hara, and I have 50,000 files in my file. Few days later, I had an opportunity to make tshuva in a very tragic manner. Chaim Blank was running, jogging in the morning, as he used to, and got a massive heart attack. And right away, Atzala took him to the hospital. 2 days later, he died. In a way, I felt horrible, but I also felt relief. Why? According to the halacha, if a person died and you sin to him, you take 10 people to his grave, and now you talk to the tomb over there, which his soul, a part of his soul stays in the grave, and you tell him all the bad things you did to him, and you save the embarrassment. You don't have to look at his eyes. So now I can go and ask for forgiveness from his grave. So I said, that's going to be much easier. So I took 10 guys older than Bar Mitzvah. I sent them my email if they can come with me to the grave of Chaim Blank. "Dear friends, I'm in a very embarrassing situation and need your help. I made a sin to Chaim Blank. And I want to ask for forgiveness from him. Please come to me to the cemetery on Friday at 10 o'clock a.m. that I can do it." Friday arrived. I went to the cemetery, Menuchat Olamim, rest in peace. It was a cool day. Very depressing, clouds, gray day, dark, matching my mood. I felt it's much easier to ask forgiveness from a dead person than from a living person. But it's really not so easy. Even that I felt horrible. In front of 10 men, standing in front of the grave, I felt very disturbed. If not the email that I got directly from God, I wouldn't have the guts to do it. I went to his grave with these 10 guys. I started to cry. For the first time since my test started, I felt relief because a river of tears started to come out. And I started to say non-stop everything from the beginning to the end in front of this minyan of people. "I jumped to conclusion. I criticize you. I made you horrible damage. I misjudge your professional way, with no foundation, with no backup. I'm ashamed. I was a hypocrite. I pretend I'm a friend and I wasn't. I am the only reason for your income to drop. My cruel comment caused you your financial stress and in the end brought to your death. If I didn't do it with a sword, I did it with my tongue. Words can kill. And I hope I'm not counted as a murderer in heaven. These words cannot really describe my real feeling. I'm so sorry, Chaim. I wish I would never open my mouth. And I started to read from Shulchan Aruch, Orach Chaim, Taf, Resh, Vav, verse 2. 606, this is the chapter, verse 2. Chatati le'Elokei Israel, I sin to the God of Israel and to Chaim Blank, Zichrono Livracha, may he bless in peace. I ruin his reputation and so forth. And each one of the 10 people started to scream, Machul lecha, machul lecha, machul lecha. You are forgiven, you are forgiven, you are forgiven. The 10 guys that came to do me a favor, they felt just as embarrassed as me. Why? Why?
Because they were witnessing it.
No. Why they were embarrassed?
Because they remember things that they did, no?
Because they think, look at this guy. For one thing he did, look what he's doing. What are we going to do for all our Lashon Hara? No? If you're judging a court and somebody got caught for doing something that you do every day, you feel horrible to hear what he has to say, because you know you're nothing better, no? That's the truth. So they were embarrassed just as much as me. When the ceremony over, they quickly disappeared. And I also returned to my home, feeling relief that finally I made it. But few days later, what took place made me pay a very physical and emotional price. This visit to the cemetery took the last drop of my energy. I went home exhausted. I fell on the bed. I fell asleep completely through Shabbat. Sunday I woke up, sleeping 2 days. Sunday morning I went to Shachrit, to the synagogue. I sat in my routine place to put my tefillin on. And I saw that the person in front of me looks familiar from the back. I recognized the back of his head. I said, cannot be, it looks like Chaim Blank. It looks like Chaim Blank. I felt very inconvenient. I hope that that's an imagination. The man turned around and I got the shock of my life. Who was it? Chaim Blank, sitting in a shul in front of me Sunday morning. He did not accept my apology and returned from the world of the souls to run after me, I thought. I fainted right away. When they woke me up in the shul, I saw all my friends around me. Are you okay? They were all worried. I say, Chaim, why you came here, Chaim? I was all panicking. Chaim said, why won't I come? I'm coming here every day to this minyan. He said, but what about your heart attack? He said, what heart attack? He says, slowly I tried to rise. And I'm thinking to myself, it was only a dream. It's not true. Chaim never died. I did not go to a cemetery. I did not send an email to God. And I never got an email back from God. It was all last night's dream. The dream was so real that I didn't even realize I'm dreaming. Just like sometimes it happens when you wake up in the morning and you think it really happened. Shortly after, I went back to my reality. I finished Tfilat Shachrit and I drove to work. Ironically, I was very disappointed that the dream wasn't real. I thought I got rid of that. But the truth is, I never got an email from God. When I got to work, my friend Shlomi Brown was waiting for me in the office. He said, did you hear the latest news about Abraham? I said, Abraham? Yeah, one of the workers in the office. We used to make fun of him all the time. He was a real loser. I was about to say, hey, what's the story with that loser? But I stopped myself. Right away, I remember all the feathers that are still flying from the highest building in town with the wind to all over the world. I saw myself running to all directions, trying to grab as many feathers as possible in my net and missing them because they're flying here and there and I'm too slow. I saw all the tombs in a cemetery. I went completely to depression. I remember all the emails, 189 emails, all the responses, all the dream, everything came to me like reality. I turned around to this guy Shlomi, from this guy, and I ran away from the place. Like he has a contagious disease or something. I didn't stand next to him. 50,000 emails in my file, it's enough. I don't need 50,001. I had no intention ever to fill up the file with more emails. I didn't lose my mind. That moment I made up my mind, I will never speak one word of Lashon Hara for the rest of my life. I know it's not easy, but I'm so persistent with my decision, and I realized that this is really what the mission of God, what He gave me, without being a prophet, without getting a mission, without going around the world. What is it? Not to say one more word of Lashon Hara. This is the end of this email. Many times you see you have friends, you get into arguments with them about kosher food. Very important kosher food, no? Chalav Israel! Not Chalav Israel! Rasha! Kemach Yashan! No Kemach Yashan! This, according to that kashrut, does not badat. This, fighting, arguing, in the end, a flood of Lashon Hara, which is a billion times worse than eating this food 5,000 times. The argument between two Jews, kosher, not kosher, two fools, for sure it's kosher. The chance that it will be milk from a pig, or from a camel, is 1 to 1 billion in America. Who is going to sell you camel milk? Who is going to send you donkey milk? What's the chance it's going to happen? In the past 30, 40 years, the rules here is very strict. They'll find you sell milk that is not cow, you're out of business, billions of dollars your company lose, you're out of the stock market, they shut you off, you go to jail. It's America, it's not, they're not playing games. You can get 50 years in prison. You saw what happened to the poor Rubashkin. Some illegal people not paying 100% taxes, 50 years in prison, or 150, I don't know how much he got. They make sure he'll never get out of jail with cruelty like he never saw. But the idea is, a company has so much to lose by selling not 100% according to what they write in the ingredients or this. It's such a big damage it can cause them. They'll never dare to do it. And we are so strict. Check. Yeah. Chalav Israel. Not Chalav Israel. We pay double. We pay triple. And now, yeah, no. And in the end, Lashon Hara like a machine gun. Lashon Hara is like genocide. Nobody's hands is shaking. Nobody's mouth is shaking. It's become a habit. Every day. Lashon Hara, Lashon Hara. What Lashon Hara? It's like million, billion times drinking not Chalav Israel. So I said to the people, you're so machmir in all these things, which is very important, don't get the wrong idea. Very important to be machmir in everything. In everything you can, it's the more the better. The more you do, the more Hashem is impressed from you. Of course. But how can it be that when it comes to life and death, you're very lenient? Let's murder another 1,000. Let's murder another 10,000. And when it comes to minor sins, minor, if you can even call it sins, you're very, very righteous. You know why? Because the Satan have you around his finger. He's laughing at you from morning to night. You know, from morning to night. That's what happened. A guy comes to yeshiva. 2 weeks he's in yeshiva. Already has a nice beard. His peot begins to grow. A month later, he has a black hat. He still doesn't know how to read one line in a Gemara. 2 weeks later, you come, Shlomi, come here, have some sweet pineapple here. No, I don't touch candies anymore. Okay, it's a wafer. No, it's olam hazeh, it's too much. I already decided, that's it. I read the book of the Rambam, I read about the Ramchal, the Ari HaKadosh, how they used to live. I'm going to be like them, Bezrat. 20 emails from his Goya every day, still in his email, sending her picture, Facebook. He doesn't eat cream cake. Tzadik, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, understand what's happening? When a Jew doesn't have foundation, he goes to all direction without foundation, without order, without instruction, is the most dangerous thing. People like this made the worst damages to the Jewish nation. The worst. Why? They don't have foundation. One of the examples to what I say is, look what happened now in Israel. There is thousands of criminals, drug addicts, drug dealers, all of them join some cult in Israel. They have one Rebbe. All of them join him. They continue to smoke drugs, continue to play their goyish music, continue to wake up at 11 or 12 or do all kinds of things. They really never became Baalei Tshuva. They put them all in one neighborhood. They all started to put all kinds of fur hats, even though it's nothing to do with their tradition of their grandparents. And all of a sudden, all the dirt's coming out. All these 10 years of all this fake illusion movie came out. Arrogance, the same. Lies, the same. All of them knocking on the door, give me money that I can go on a trip once a year with all the buddies, you know, over there. What's this? This is the way the Torah is. This is what really Hashem wants. Hashem wants you to worship a man, to worship a grave, to be a sheep, like thousands of sheep, how they sent all of them to one direction, so you're one of them. Why can't you use your head to think, what does Hashem want from me? Not from all my friends. From me. I'm different than my friends. Most of my friends are stupid. Does it mean that I have to be stupid like them? Why they stupid? Because they make sins every day. Big sins. I already realized that's not the right way. Just because all my friends are destroying their soul for eternity, I'm going to be one of them? No. If I can save them with me, very good. Most likely it won't happen. Let me save myself. What's step number one? Get rid of all these losers. A loser, it's not someone who doesn't touch drugs or doesn't touch cigarettes or doesn't dress with his pants down that all his butt is outside in the middle of Queens Boulevard. Someone who does that is the loser. Even if 20 of your friends are like this and you're not like this, you are the winner and all of them are zero garbage. That's what they are. They have no personality. They have no direction in life. Whatever they give them, they eat. Whatever they decide for them, they do. They don't have their own personality. They see all this going, do it. All this kushim in Harlem go with their parents down. The next thing, half of the Jews do the same. You are a son of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. You imitate these monster criminals that walks with guns in their things and rob places, putting guns and murdering people and selling drugs to kids and killing them, and they put their pants down, and you, the son of Hashem, wants to be the same? You're not killing yourself from the embarrassment? Listening to their garbage music that contaminate your soul and make you a monster? You don't realize? Even in Arab countries, they realize not to allow this rap music. Why? It destroys the souls, the Arab says. In Japan, the same things, in some places they started to realize. It ruins our culture. It ruins our children. In Israel, all the public school dropped by hundreds of percent in their level in math and in all learnings. Why? They all became garbage of human beings. The worst human being on earth. Why? What you hear, what you see, what you eat, that's what you are. You know, they have a very, very famous thing. Tell me who your friends, I tell you who you are. You're not going to be able to come and say, Rabbi, I'm not like my friends. You see all my friends the way they are? I'm not really like this. As long as you are with them, you're nothing better than them. Some people come and tell me, you know, Rabbi, We know what you're talking about. You're talking about all these people who worship a rabbi that die and they make him the Mashiach and they worship him and they say never die and he runs the world. We know, we also don't like it. But it's not all of them like this. Some believe in this, some don't. Baloney. All of them like this. You want me to prove to you? All of them like this. I'll prove to you. If I have 100 friends, 50 of them are murderers. Murderers! This is their job. They go to murder every night. And I'm hanging up with them and marry my daughters to their sons. Sitting in the same table every night, eating dinner together. Giving them rights to work. Sleeping over in their house for the weekend. I'm like them or I'm not like them? If I'm not disgusted from them, if I'm not separating me and my children from this, I'm just like them. That means I'm 100% supportive of them. Right? You ever saw Shomrei Shabbos that like to move in with Mechalele Shabbat and live together with them on Shabbat when they Mechalel Shabbat? Doesn't happen. Did you see a Jew that is staying away from smokers on purpose move in with the roommates that smoke non-stop? It doesn't happen. Did you see an intelligent professor and nerd from college that all day reading science moving in with a drug dealer that curse every second together? He cannot be near him more than 2 minutes. He'll faint. Why? It's two opposites. I am sitting with him that he kissed the feet of Buddha every day and he say he never died and he's the God and all the nonsense that they do and it doesn't bother them and they're all cousins, friends, together, holidays together, Leila Seder together. Who are you telling stories? It's 100% like them. Once, if I'm going to know that the group that I belong to, which means my synagogue in that case, my synagogue became an idol worshippers, I will never step one step in that building ever again. Why? If I step in, that means I hate Hashem. It's against the Torah. If 100 people worship an idol and Hashem cannot stand it, and I'm there like nothing happened, and I give them donation and support them, same thing, what we are complaining against all these Arab terrorists. How many percent of the Arabs in the world are terrorists? Not even 1%. Why are we judging 99% of them? Why? You know why? Because we know that almost every one of them is very happy when the terrorism happened. That's why we are angry at the rest of them. We know that not every Ahmad blowing buses. But when Saddam shot missiles, the Palestinians were dancing on the roofs. When September 11 happened, they make parties all over the world. They're showing you that they're very supportive of what the murderers are doing. That's why we don't like them as much. If I would see an Ahmed that come on television and say, I'm disgusted from the way my brothers behave, these filthy murderers that kill children and innocent people on the street just like that, then he will be a hero for me. 100%. Yeah, whatever. For sure, I don't have anything against him because he's an Arab or because he's a Goy or because whatever the case is. Why? He's an honest, decent person that is not one of them. But if all of them together, it doesn't bother me. I sit with this terrorist and the other one and the other one. I'm like them. What is the difference? I'm like them. That's why the Torah says, "Bemoshav letzim, you cannot see it." Nobody has the guts to make cherem today. You know, today, nobody has. Everyone is afraid to talk.
Political.
You know what it is? Today it's dangerous to talk. People who were a little bit more brave than me and they spoke more openly with names, they couldn't come out of their house for months. Mamash like a mafia. There's one tzaddik in Tzfat, Rav Yirmiya HaKohen, Rosh Yeshiva Or Yakar, he wrote a kuntres, a short book, about the Avodah Zarah of all these cults in Israel. He specifically spoke about one cult that have all the problems now on the news. 6 months, he couldn't come out of his door.
What cult?
Whatever. 6 months, he couldn't come.
Jewish?
Yeah, Israeli, Jewish, American, all one cult, worship an idol. You know, and he couldn't come out. He compared them to all the other idol worshippers, and he showed one by one how they do exactly the same thing that all these despicable idol worshippers are doing. And 6 months he couldn't come out of his home. But when he finally came out of his home, guess what happened? Hashem sent him a huge prize. One of his, the Baal Tshuva on his yeshiva, had a father that is not religious at all, and he was the only son. The father suddenly died and gave his son tens of millions of dollars, and he gave him 20% of the money. One person. And right away, his yeshiva have money now for 20 years. What? Yeah, he passed the test. Hashem is watching everything. Everyone in the end gets what they deserve. How Sefer Tehillim starts? When you come to write your book, every author of a book wants to start with a bomb, right? Usually, if you really pay attention, the introduction to the religious books are the best. Many people skip that, but this is the best. The introduction is very full of stories, interesting things from the life of the rabbi that wrote the book. Beautiful things in the introductions. Sometimes you can fill up a whole lecture just from an introduction of the book. When a person comes to write a book and he wants to influence the world, he has to make sure that the first page is one of the strongest pages in a book. If he would start slow, some people would leave. So I start with this email. First 2 or 3 minutes was slow. Few people already left. Right? No? Why? Because people don't have patience. If you start slow and then later you do it good, some of the people lose their patience and they leave. But the end is great, because you see, you get the message finally. Not everyone has patience. Sometimes people look for the first 5 minutes, and same thing in movies. They go first 10 minutes, they don't like it, they take it out, they don't watch. In the end, they hear everyone speak about it, and they think, I saw that, it's garbage, it's not. But they don't understand that sometimes you need patience. But if you really want to make sure everyone will never forget your book, open it with a bomb. How David HaMelech opened one of the most legendary books in history that even Chinese, Christians, Arabs, everyone read. What is it? Tehillim. Psalms. Chinese read Tehillim. They have Tehillim in Chinese, they have Tehillim in English, they have in Arabic, they have in any language you want. No, it's a part of the Tanakh. Christians also follow the Bible. Muslims also follow it. Cannot. It's an integral part of Judaism and of the truth of the world. And David HaMelech, no, King David, in Arabic it's Malik Daoud. Daoud, that's David. Whatever, it's the same person. No, how did he start his book? Ashrei Ha'ish. אשר לא הלך בעצת רשעים. איך אומרים אשרי? שלוות. שלוות is a professional interpreter. איך אומרים אשרי האיש in English? אשרי. אשרי means lucky, אושר, happiness. אשרי האיש, it means how lucky is the person that this is what he did. It has to be a better way to translate it. But one of the 4 things that David HaMelech started with is ובמושב לצים לא ישב. He did not sit among clowns, jokers, losers, low life. All fall into that category of Moshav Letzim. If you want to know what Moshav Letzim is in Halakha, let me tell you. First, a stadium. Game, this team against that team, Maccabi against Hapoel, whatever, Yankees against, who knows, I don't know their names, whatever. That's called Moshav Letzim. Why? Because gathering 50, 40, 20, 30,000 people gathering in a place, violence, cursing, screaming like animals, for such nonsense, a piece of leather, if it went into the net or not, that's what makes people happy or make them depressed and kill each other and breaks people's heads. That shows that these people not only are worse than animals in their level. Of course, when they hear it, they're going to say, this guy is crazy, he's fanatic, he's too strict. But that's the truth. Nothing will help. The truth is, thank you, the truth is, Moshav Letzim is sitting with low life, people that are empty from wisdom. If a person sits in a stadium with his little quarter yarmulke, whatever, not all, he can be Shomer Shabbat, and he cries when his team losing, I'm not talking about the gamblers. Gamblers is already money. They cry. They also cry in the casino. They cry when the boss didn't pay them the paycheck. It's different. That's business already. I'm talking, they cry because this team is not the champion. Abba, wow! Wow, for a week he's depressed in the room. Doesn't come out to eat. Moishi, why you don't eat? The Knicks didn't win. You know, it's I saw something beautiful. You know, one Rav Shalom Shvadron, you know, if you think you know a good speaker, think again. If you only hear 1 minute of his lecture, even in Hebrew or in Yiddish, you don't understand. But even just to hear his voice, you feel like electric is flowing in your veins. You feel goosebumps all over your body just from his sincere look and voice. Believe me, you start to shake.
His name again?
Rav Shalom Shvadron, a Magid HaGadol, is an amazing speaker. And he was speaking to the highest level of people. Not speaking to beginners. But somehow, one Baal Tshuva, one guy that became religious, got into his lesson, into his lectures, into his learning. Teaching. And one day he see that this guy didn't show up. Now usually this guy was coming every evening to learn between 8 and 10 in the evening. The next day he didn't show up again. I say he has to be sick. One night you missed the shiur, could be an accident, could be a wedding, maybe your brother was married. It has to be a reason. Two nights in a row. He said, let's wait one more day. If he doesn't come tomorrow, I'll pay him a visit. Bikur cholim, it's mitzvah. The next day he didn't show up. So he ran quickly to his house. He opened up the door. He sees perfectly healthy. Red, nice, smiling. Ah, Rabbi, what an honor you came to my home. What honor. I thought I'm going to see you in bed with ice on your forehead. What is this? You look to me very healthy. What happened? You didn't come last night, the night before. What happened to the shiur? I said, Rabbi, I should have told you in advance, but I was a little embarrassed. This week I won't come. I said, well, it's the champion of the world in soccer. It was the quarterfinal, semifinal, and tonight or tomorrow, whatever, is the final. Kaduregel, football, soccer. Rav Shalom Shvadron didn't know what this game is. So I told him, what is this? What is this football? Football like this. So Rabbi, you know, you have 11 against 11. They put the ball in the middle of the field. It's 100 yards from one side to the other and 50 wide. And there's two goals and there's a goalie. And you have to kick the ball. The ball is made from leather. He explained him like you explain, you know, to a complete ignorant. And then you have to kick the ball and the boy fly and goes into the net. And there's a line. If it passes the line, you get a goal and you win. Whoever gets more goals, Rav Shalom Shvadron say, and this is, you mean this is famous all over the world? He said, yeah. So why? What's so difficult about it? I can do the same thing. Bring me a ball, I'll show you how I kick it to the net. What's the problem to kick? I sometimes kick stones on the street. I told him, no, Rabbi, you don't get the point. It's not so easy to make the ball go into the net. They are defenders. They are preventing you from kicking the ball. They're blocking the way. You have to be very talented. You go left, right. You have to pass them. You have to trick them. You have to go, you know, double team with your friend. There's a lot of techniques here. Until you overcome the defender, and that's how you score a goal. So Rav Shalom Shvadron, which was a genius, Alav HaShalom, he said to him, oh, your ears should listen to your foolish mouth, what you just told me right now. When it becomes a mission, an achievement, success, when the ball goes into the net, right? That's the goal here. Why you call it a goal? That's my goal in life, to get the ball inside. Why you appreciate someone who kicked the ball into the net? Every fool can do it. Because there is resistance. There's obstacles. Itnagdut, resistance. Ah, when you break the resistance, you are a hero. Ezu agibor, hakovesh et itzro. Overcoming your test. When to come to learn Torah every night in yeshiva, it's not only when there's nothing to do. Rabbi, today I came. Why? There's no birthday party in my list, in my calendar. Half of the people who don't show up to the lecture, guess what excuse they have? Birthday party. Today I got a phone call from a woman. Believe me, she's a righteous woman. Very much. Very, very much. Be'emet, righteous woman. Be'emet, trying to keep every little mitzvah. Husband is also a person that keeps mitzvot, but he's not in her spiritual level. She called me up around 6 o'clock and she told me, I have a big dilemma. What's the dilemma? I want to come tonight to the lecture, to my first lecture, the lecture before I came here. It's every Monday and every Wednesday I speak. Well, but tonight, my best friend, she make a special party to her father, which is a Holocaust survivor, showing a movie that they make, professional movie about his life. They took pictures from the camps, how he came to America, and they invited all the family and friends today, and they're making a surprise party that the old man, which is in his 80s, I believe, or 90s, whatever it is, is going to come, he doesn't know what, and today they're going to show, they color all his pictures, and the friends that spoke about him, and letters that he had, and they made a professional clip. And she say, it starts exactly at 8 o'clock, and I expect you to come? So I told her, I don't understand. From someone like you, I expect more. What is the dilemma exactly? That you say mazal tov to the old man that they show his pictures? And you give up an hour and a half words of Torah, which is billions of mitzvot? You compare this to this? Go, the lecture finish at 10. 10 or 5, you go there. It's all local, no? So now she has an answer. She said, no, no, it's not so simple. Why? This woman came to all my parties, all my events, never missed one. And she told me, hey, I'm warning you, don't be ungrateful. Remember, I came to all your invitations. No? What do you think? She has a case now or no? Judaism is, one rule in Judaism, first rule is to be grateful. What's the word Yehudi means? Modeh. Yehudi has the one meaning. If somebody asks you what Judaism is, one word, modeh. One word with two meanings. Modeh has two meanings. Modeh means thank you, and the second meaning is, I admit that that's the truth. That's what it means, modeh. Same word, two meanings. That's what Judaism is all about. That's it. So obviously, to be bracha, thank you Hashem. Another bracha, thank you Hashem. Birkat HaMazon, thank you Hashem. Shmonat Shmonaisre, half of it is thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Right? Everything. Birkot HaShachar, thank you that I see. Thank you that I walk. Thank you that I have shoes. Thank you that this. Thank you that I have clothes. Thank you that I can learn Torah. Thank you that I'm a Jew. Thank you. So many thank yous. Everywhere, thank you. Leila Seder, thank you that you took us out of Egypt. Shabbat, thank you that you created the world in 6 days, and in 7 you rested and you made us like you. Tefillin, memory of the exodus of Egypt, so it's also thank you. Brit Milah, thank you that you make us different than all the nations. Everything is thank you. So now she has a point, no? What do you think? I say that she doesn't even have 1% a point in her claim. Zero. Why? Someone who thinks that Hashem's intention was to be grateful to people on his expense is nothing but a fool. Thinking, kabed et avicha ve'et imecha. My father tell me, get in a car on Shabbat. I'm driving, don't worry. I'm your father, no? Respect your father, the Torah say. Why did Hashem say, ani Hashem? Not on my expense, my friend. Your father do anything to tell you to violate one little sin from the Torah or from the Rabbanan, there is no permission whatsoever to hear him, to listen to him. Eat this bread. It's okay. You don't need netilah. Okay. I don't have patience to get you water now. No. Forget about it. Eat. Not allowed to eat. Eat. It's only fish. Don't worry. It's kosher. Eat. It's tomatoes. It's salad. So what if it's a diner? Eat. Don't worry. Don't be fanatic. Not allowed to listen to him. Get in the car or I break your bones. You're not allowed to get in. Get in the car or I divorce you, he said to his wife. He's not allowed to get in the car. I divorce her. She lose $10 million. He's a very rich man. No problem. She lose $1 billion. No problem. I have a mansion that worth $100 million in Westchester. And it goes on fire. To put the fire off on Shabbat, what mitzvah is this? It's a sin from the Oraita or from the Rabbanan? No. The Oraita, when you put the fire off, is only if you have intention to re-put the fire on. If you shut the p'tilia, in order for you to light it again later in a better way, because when you burn it for a minute, and then you put it off, next time it would light better, because it's all connected together now. That's the only way it's the Oraita. To put fire off, just to put fire off, is the Rabbanan. $100 million house! $100 million house! Burning on Shabbat! You take the children out and let the house burn. If you have goyim outside, you can scream, whoever puts the fire off for sure will not lose. And they get the point and they run to... You're not even allowed to tell him, Ahmed, bring the roast! Save my house! Not allowed. What do you mean not allowed? $100 million, I worked 50 years for it. One sin de Rabbanan, you're not allowed. How can it be? Because a sin de Rabbanan is 1.5 sins. It's worse than a sin from the Torah. Sin from the Torah is only one, you against Hashem. You pay for it. Not listening to the rabbi is the sin from the Rabbanan, what the rabbis made. And you're violating automatically a sin from the Torah, because in Parashat Shoftim, Hashem say, everything the Chachamim taught, every decree they made, every halacha they made, you must listen to them. Every doubt you have, whatever they answer you, you must listen to them. Do not move left or right from what they instructed you to do. And if you're going to do it, you deserve to die. Deserve to die. Do not leave him. Ubiarta Aram Israel. Why? You disrespect my holy men in the world, those who learn all their life Torah and taught Torah to the nation of Israel. You disrespect them, you have a problem with me. What is it like? Imagine I show up in the office of Microsoft New York. Hey, Christine, make me espresso. Make sure it's good, sweet. Sir, who are you? Do I know you? You'll know me, don't worry. Quick, make me coffee. Hey, you, go down to the restaurant, bring me a nice Chinese meal. You, when I talk, don't make noise, okay? You, next time, don't wear pink. I don't like people who dress like women. Understand? Excuse me, sir, do we know you? Yeah, I'm the new boss here. From now on, I'm your boss. Give me the checkbook, give me the stamp, give me this, give me that. What happened after a minute? Either I get a punch, or the police will come and arrest me, no? One of the two, no? Yeah. So after they kick me from the window, and I all got dirty, and my new suit went in the mud, the next day I show up, but this time I come hand with hand with Bill Gates, the real boss of Microsoft. And Bill Gates puts his arm around my shoulder and say, ladies and gentlemen, I wanted to inform you, I didn't have a chance yet. This is the new manager of Microsoft New York. You know, it doesn't matter, he looks like a fool. It doesn't matter, he doesn't know anything about computer, but that's my decision. Everything he say, you must listen to him. You have a problem with him, you have a problem with me. And he left. 10 seconds, that's all. From that moment on, when I go like this, Christine, 2 espresso, please. What happened? Yes, sir, yes, sir. Yeah, please, give me a minute, please. She's shaking. 5 times she spilled the coffee because I went like this. What changed? When I went to the guy, no more pink, what do you think he did? He burned it in front of my eyes. Yes, sir, of course, no more pink. Put it in a shredding machine. What changed from yesterday to today? One word of the real boss. When Gates say, I'm the new boss, I'm Bill Gates from now on. When Hashem wrote in the Torah, everything you ask them, whatever they instructed you from my Torah, you must listen to them. Do not move left or right. Not only to listen 80%. You must listen to everything they say. Not listening to them right away, it's a violation from the Torah. That's why it's so important. So that's what Rav Shalom Shvadron told the guy, what do you think, the Yetzer Hara would let you come to a Shiur Torah? Every night you're going to have shawarma waiting for you? Every night another thing? No! To come, it's only when there's nothing to do. When tonight is the best game! Like this stupid culture, Super Bowl! Wow! Bring beer! Wow! Wow! All this nonsense, empty culture of all these losers. I have to be like them? Why can't I be a son of God, for real? What all this nonsense? What all this? What all this? Not to talk about the time we waste. Okay, we'll finish with one last story from Rav Shalom Shvadron. Since we mention him, I will tell you a story that he said that will knock you off your chairs. But before I do it, I would like just to finish what I started about the Moshav Letzin. Who is Moshav Letzin? Jokers, people who need all the time to make jokes to get attention from their people around them. That show that, first of all, their confidence is low and they try to get it by getting attention, and they'll do anything provocative, anything stupid to get attention. Today the psychologists call it negative attention. The Torah says stay away from these people like from fire, because they'll take you to hell with them. They won't get you out of there. Why? Because you decided to follow them instead of making them follow you. That's a big failure. Second, stadium, sport, all kinds of games, competition. This is the culture of the Greeks. Sport comes from the word Sparta. That's Moshav Letzin. A Jew doesn't belong there. Third, all kinds of places when men and women mix together, drinking alcohol, dancing, listening to all kinds of goyish music, a Jew is not allowed to step there. It's the wedding of his sister. Hashem comes before your sister. Your parents will cry. They'll cut you off the wheel. No problem. I told you the story about the doctor. A doctor in Israel that is not religious got a call on Shabbat. A boy has very high fever. They're afraid of on his life. He comes to an apartment in Bnei Brak. The people are starving from poverty. The father is an avrech in a kollel. Many kids live in one tiny room, very old apartment in Bnei Brak, on Shabbat. Life risk is life risk. He had to call a private doctor. He cannot drive a car now to a hospital. He has a local doctor. The doctor is not religious. He comes with his bag, with his car. He comes in. He checked the boy, he checked this, blood, this, whatever he did. He told him, false alarm, relax, 2-3 days, the boy will be okay. Here, get him this medicine, in the meantime I'll give you some. Tomorrow you get him this, 2 days he will be fine. And now he told him, the doctor on Shabbat, you see, a religious man, he say, okay, 500 shekel please. 500 shekel. It's about $150. So the father, poor father now, is Shabbat. He doesn't know what to do. If I'm going to have to write him a check, I'm going to make a sin from the Torah. Writing two letters is a sin from the Torah. Not giving him the check, it's also a sin from the Torah, because he doesn't understand Shabbat. He's going to say, look at this guy, religious guy with all his beard and yarmulke and this. He's a crook. He's not paying me. I came to cure his son. He doesn't understand that Shabbat is not only not to smoke. It's like some Jews think, Rabbi, I'm not lighting fire on Shabbat, but he drives the car. One cigarette, one time you start the car is 1,000 million cigarettes. Every time you hit the gas. Rabbi, I don't touch fire on Shabbat. Little match, it doesn't light. The car, 5,000 cigarettes. 50,000. 500,000. Just from here to Manhattan is 5 million cigarettes. But before he wants to make coffee, he calls his roommate, a Muslim from Morocco. Saeed, don't you drink tea? Today, Rabbi told you, you're not allowed to tell the guy to be mechalel shat. So it's machmir. Saeed, you don't make yourself tea. Saeed say, don't worry. Sure, I'm thirsty. I want tea. He put water on, then he drinks. This is very fanatic. 2 minutes later, he goes to the car, start the car. Blinker, a separate mechalel shabbat. Turning the stereo on, another mechalel shabbat. Pushing the disc in, another mechalel shabbat. Moving four trucks, 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 more. Each one skila, separate skila that you're going to have to pay for it separately. One trial and another trial and another trial. It will never end. And Rabbi, you know what? I don't light fire in Shabbat. I had a cousin like this. Tzadika. Lo madlika esh b'Shabbat. About driving all over Tel Aviv. Ignorance. It's not even stupidity. It's ignorance. People have no idea what Judaism is. They don't understand what Torah is, what halacha is, what test is, why Hashem did it. Nothing. So, Moshav Letzim has a list of things you don't want to be. So the Rofe, the doctor doesn't know what to do. So he decided, I'm going to write with my mouth. If you write with your mouth, it's a sin from the Rabbanan, not from the Oraita. He went like this, and he wrote one word, three letters, Aleph. Why? To write Chamesh Meot, how many letters? Chet, Mem, Shin is the first word. Meot is four letters, it's seven letters. Chamesh Meot, so it's seven letters. Aleph, it's only three letters. Better to write three letters than seven. But it's double of the amount. He won 500 shekel, he wrote Aleph. So he said like this, I'm making a sin from the Rabbanan to prevent Chilul Hashem, which is a very big sin. And I don't really have a choice because this doctor is not going anywhere unless if I pay, it's going to be a big embarrassment here. So hopefully Hashem will accept my mistake, you know, with mercy. That's what he was thinking. So the doctor looked at the check. So I'm sorry, I didn't say 1,000 shekel, I said 500. Told him, you know, it's Shabbat today, and we're not allowed to write. I was embarrassed to tell you. If I'll tell you, you won't believe me, and it will create an embarrassment. So I prefer to pay you double, and as long as I'll mechalel Shabbat less as possible. So the doctor say, you don't make me an impression of a very rich guy. You're willing to pay extra 500 shekel just not to write few stupid letters? That's what's so important to you? He said, yes, that's the divine order. It's not a joke. So the doctor said, okay, if that's your wish, that's your wish. He took the check and he left. But Motzei Shabbat, Saturday night, he comes back to the house with the check changed, 500 shekel changed. The doctor gave him a check, he said, that's your change. But the doctor said to him, you know, all Shabbat I was thinking about your sacrifice. You really believe it's divine, this Shabbat? It's so real for you? Maybe you're wrong, Maybe it's a mistake. You know how they ask all these questions? 10, 15 minutes later, they already dance with you, with a tzitzit, like in a seminar. First day, that's the chance to tell you that we have a seminar February 4th in Hebrew, in hotel. Very, very cheap price. Don't even cover a quarter of the cost. Most good people donate. Probably peanuts. With great food, great caterer, another great speaker of Tzvika Ben David comes from Israel. Every one of you or your friends that speaks Hebrew, it's an adventure you don't want to miss. It's right here in a hotel in New Jersey, less than an hour drive from here.
How much?
Probably around, don't catch me, but around $100 a person for a whole full weekend, which is just the food costs double without the hotel. Shabbaton, very good, and they're going to have music on Motzei Shabbat. Everyone who speaks Hebrew, please contact me. I'll direct you to the right person. It's for beginners, but you know, I always speak according to the people who sit in front of me. Right. It's supposed to be for beginners, and I see half of the people are Shomer Shabbat, I have to speak in a higher level, you know. Okay. I don't give them proofs if I know they Shomer Shabbat. They already know the Torah is real. Anyway, back to our doctor. So the doctor started to talk to him. He gave him few proofs that we give in a seminar. Today this doctor is completely Haredi. What made the doctor Haredi? What made him religious? Devotion of a poor Jew for the truth. Well, it's not a joke here. You have no idea what he won. For this 500 shekel he was willing to give. Anyway, he didn't lose it. Because you never lose from doing the wish of Hashem. Never. Even though it looks in your eyes you just lost. You never lose. You see all these crooks in the business, two people, one plumber, one plumber, one electrician, one electrician, one mechanic, one mechanic. One is a crook, one is 100% honest. In the first few years out of school, he opened the garage, he opened a garage. Almost in all cases, the liar, the crook, makes a lot more money than the honest one in the first few years. Check 10 years later, who has much better life and blessing and make more money? For sure, always the honest one. Why? Because if every crook will see right away that he lose, nobody will ever be a crook. There's no test. If every honest person see right away becomes a millionaire because he's honest, there's no test. It has to be mixed. But in the end, Hashem calculates the balance of everyone. Everyone gets what he deserves. They made in Israel on the television, they have a show. It's called Yatzata Tzadik. Shamati, I never saw it, but this is the story. I read it in a book. Yatzata Tzadik. Too much noise here. Too much noise. Yatzata Tzadik. So it says, they took a woman, a widow, with kids in the house, and they told her, we're going to make a short in the outlet, on purpose. And you know, now you need to do something, the wire maybe got ripped sometimes. And we called three different electricians with a candy camera. They don't know that they are filmed. She called the first one, a typical Israeli crook, comes in with his ego, yeah ma'am, what's the problem? This is what I did, I connected the teapot, the electric teapot, and all the lights went off. Where did you do it? Over here? He looks, yeah. 2,500 shekel. You already know. You don't have to check, you don't have to open. No, it's a common mistake. It happens every day. I know what happened already. I have to change all the wires all the way from down there. It's almost half a day of work. So she said, okay, give me your card. I'll think about it. Invited another person. 1,500 shekel. Not 2,500. 1,500. Same stories. Then they invited a third person. Then they invited a third person, his name is Hasdian, a Persian Jew with a yarmulke. He comes, she tells him the story, Hasdian. He says, hey, I know what happened. 100 shekel. Nothing. One was 1500 shekel. No, wait a minute. No. I gave you the wrong number. One was 1500 shekel. One was 2500 shekel. 2500. 1500. And one, 120 shekel. 2500, 120. You get the point? 120 shekel, he says to her. She said, that's all, you sure? She said, yeah. It's about 20 minutes walk. I open, I take two wires, I connect, I close, I still did good. I will walk in 20 minutes. You know what? You caught me in a good mood. Only 100 shekel, not 120. She said, why? I was very happy with your price. I already told you yes. Why you took another 20 shekel off? He said, you know, I see you with all the kids. Why can't I do a mitzvah today? He said, I want to do something for you. They came out from the room with the candy camera. Sir, yatzata tzadik, pictures, music. He's a millionaire today. The phone doesn't stop. Everyone who needs electrician, chazdian. We trust you 100%. I saw a mechanic in Brooklyn in my own eyes. I used to give lecture in his house. His wife and the children became religious, except one son, who was working for El Al. It was a big shot. It took time with him. I believe today is also religious, because a few years ago I heard that he's starting to wake up. And the father became religious, but he's not a learner, you know, he's all day in the garage. Now people think, only if you're in yeshiva, you're a tzaddik. Cannot be, not to be in yeshiva and to be a tzaddik, but sometimes the test in life is harder than in yeshiva. To be a businessman, millions of dollars you can make by faking one thing, one lie, one trick, and not to do it is a very big test. Believe me, it's very big. One time I took my car to him, because now I know them, I give lectures there. In those days I used to use him as a mechanic. I come to him, he check my car, he say, oh, it's going to take a few hours until they bring the part and this. In the meantime, where am I going to go? I don't have a car. So I sit over there with my book, there's a bench there, and I read. Then I see a goy, an old man, maybe 70 years old, all white hair, comes with a junky car. He comes there, he says, sir, my air conditioned compressor burned out. I need to replace my compressor, he told me. He say, how much is going to be? Told him, compressor for this car, but I'm talking to you this story maybe 12 years ago. $500, probably today it's double. $500 compressor for this car. I know, I already replaced a few like this. So the old man say, okay, do it. I guess he shopped around. That was the cheapest price. He say, go, do it. So I come back in 3 hours. In the meantime, I'm there. About 2 hours later, the old man showed up. You think the car is ready by any chance? He says, ah, yeah. He go inside, they bring him the key. He says, Sale Shalom. Go. I said, what about the payment? I said, no payment. It wasn't the compressor. It was only a fuse. He told him. Now, the old man went to a few places. They checked the car. They all told him compressor, because they're all crooks. You know, you don't know if it's a fuse or compressor. There's no way to know. Fuse is $1. Compressor is 500. Or 800, whatever they wanted to charge. So he came to him, say, change the compressor. If you would change the compressor, he's not considered a thief in Shamayim. It's a mistake of a goy. You told me to change the compressor, I changed the compressor. I'm not responsible. I followed your instruction. Even in a court here, it will be 100%. No, Yehudi, it's a different story. If a Yehudi made a mistake, you have an obligation to correct his mistake. If a goy made a mistake, you don't have an obligation to correct his mistake. You're not allowed to mislead him, you're not allowed to cheat him, you're not allowed to steal from him. But if he make mistake on his own, it's not my responsibility to look for him and tell him, hey, you know, you made a mistake. Yes, that's what I'm telling you. The man looked at him, and he said to him, psh, I never believe in my whole life that something like this will happen. He takes out a dollar. He says, okay, let me pay you for the fuse. He says, on the house, grandpa. Have a nice day. And the guy almost kissed him, believe me. You can see he's not a rich guy, what car he's driving. And he left. And I told the guy, isn't it a shame that you did such a thing that 99% of the people would fail? And you have almost no reward for it? He looks at me. He says, why? I say, you walk without a kippah, tembel. Shomer Shabbat. You eat kosher. Your wife all day learning Torah. And you make lectures in your house. People become religious. You do so many mitzvot. This man doesn't know you're a Jew. He won't go now to tell all his friends in the old age club. You saw that Jew, what a tzaddik, what an honest man. And they'll tell all the friends, you know, all people, they never stop talking. All the ladies. The Chafetz Chaim wanted the whole town to know something. So he called two neighbors, or two friends of his wife. They were old. He got them all quickly on Friday afternoon to his house. He said, I want to tell you something, but make sure nobody hears it. It's a secret. I'm telling you this. He told them, he said to his wife, consider it done. The whole town knows already. By Shabbos Friday night, everyone in town already spoke about it. Well, they like to talk. So I told him, you see, what is this? Sometimes he put this stupid baseball hat. You're embarrassed to go like a Jew. At least he would know. Baruch Hashem, in the end, he realized he put kippah. But he could have gone another 20 years like this and he won't get the Kiddush Hashem. He doesn't get Kiddush Hashem. Because if nobody knows you're a Jew, where Kiddush Hashem, he didn't do Kiddush Hashem. Think you're Puerto Rican, you're Egyptians, you anything, you can be anything. We'll finish with the story of the Rav Shalom Shvadron, and we'll finish with that. 5 more minutes and we're out of here. It says like this, that one time an old man was standing in Bnei Brak in Itzkovich. Itzkovich is a place, one minyan after the other, all the Aram, many rooms. One minyan here, right away another minyan, another minyan, another minyan, all the minyanim. So the old man, everyone knows he needs a ride to Yerushalayim, you stand 20 minutes by Itzkovich, for sure one of them goes to Yerushalayim. Put a sign, looking for a ride to Yerushalayim, you go like this. Every minute, yeah, I'm going, come. So they put the old man in a car, one guy, in a nice fancy car, and he flies to Yerushalayim. They talk a little bit on the way, as the guy entering the hills of Yerushalayim, he has to go straight, and the old man needs to go right to some kind of a neighborhood. And he said to the man, I'm sorry, I'm in a rush, I'm dropping you here in an intersection, and you find a ride over there, or maybe you can walk, it's only 10 minutes walk from here. The old man says to him, it's such a shame, such a nice guy like you, you brought me all the way from Bnei Brak to here, 1 hour ride. For another 2 minutes ride, you can put me by my door, I'm an old man, look, I'm walking with a cane. So he says to him, hey, grandpa, I'm very sorry, but I'm in a rush, I told you. I have a party tonight. I have to get ready and to go. I'm late already. He says to him, you know, the Torah said that if you do a mitzvah and you don't finish it, sometimes better not to start, he says to him. You should finish the mitzvah. So he said to him, don't you understand that I'm not right now in a position to waste another 5 minutes? I'm already late. Please get off the car. He said, if I knew that you're going to drop me here, I wouldn't agree to come with you. He says to him. Now he gets very, really angry. He said, tell me, do I owe you something? What is this? He said, yes. What? You do a mitzvah, Jew to a Jew. Yes, I can ask you to do a little better. What's the problem? What? So you know, you have the nerve, you. Now I'm regretting that I took you. So the old man said, you know what, I wish you wouldn't take me. I'm doing you a favor, I'm giving you an opportunity to do such a mitzvah. You're now talking to me that you did me a favor. I wish you wouldn't take me. Somebody else will bring me to my home and see an old man like this. So the guy said, you know what, I'm going to teach you a lesson that nobody ever taught you in your last 70 years. He makes a U-turn, He makes a U-turn and he begins to drive back to Bnei Brak. He drives to Bnei Brak full speed. The old man says, "What are you doing? I'm going to a chasuna, to an engagement party in Yerushalayim. You're putting me back in Bnei Brak. I'm going to miss the whole party. Stop!" He said to him, "I'm very sorry, my friend. I'll teach you a lesson. I'm also going to a chasuna tonight. What do you think? I came from Bnei Brak here. I won't go to mine, and you won't go to yours, and that's it." He drives all the way back to Bnei Brak, arrives to Bnei Brak, drop him there. He said, "I wish I wouldn't see you." He dropped him there, he turned around, he has a nice fancy BMW, he flies. Instead of an hour, 40 minutes, he's in back in Yerushalayim, flying. No, he comes to his place, his daughter getting engaged today, and now he has time to educate the old man, to teach him manners. He comes to the engagement party. "Where are you? We're waiting for you, you're an hour and a half late. You're supposed to be here at 7:30, it's 9 o'clock already. Where are you?" They all get angry. This is in the days there were no cell phones. No cell phone yet.
By the car.
So he said to them, "Listen, I had an emergency. I have an emergency. Now they're sitting. Let's start the party." So he says to the father of the Chatan, "Say, we have a problem." "So what's the problem?" He says, "My father didn't arrive yet," he said. "We cannot start the party without my father," he says to him. So he says to him, "Why do we care about your father now? So your father come, we're going to start the party." He said, "What do you mean? First granddaughter of my father, you won't miss the party? Plus, my mind is not clear to enjoy the party. My grandfather is a Holocaust survivor. He's an old man. Who knows what happened to him? He never late. You know what the yeke? You tell him 7:30, 7:20, standing there already. No? No? Something for sure happened. 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock. The grandfather didn't show up yet. They go crazy, fighting already behind the scene. The guests are eating and eating. They finished the whole food. We didn't start the party yet. 10:15, the old man showed up with his cane. Who does he see? The one who gave him the ride. "You? You? You go to the same party?" He says to him, "You have no idea what a rasha this guy is." The old man said to his son.
"Rasha is ra."
He said, "What rasha? This is the father of the Chatan." He said, "My granddaughter will marry his son on my dead body." He takes his cane, starts breaking the things. "Cancel the wedding! Cancel the wedding!" The guy became purple in his face. "Wow, I messed with the wrong guy." And this is also the very fancy family. So the old man, his son, is a big shot. Forget about what a nightmare. The daughter begins to cry. The Chatan is pulling his hair off. Nobody can convince the old man. He's furious. "Say, if you want me, I'm going to jump from the window and I won't allow this wedding. Cancel it right away. Everyone go home! Go home!" He screams. He finished the night. Sends everyone home. Rav Shalom Shvadron said that story. And then this is how he finished the story, and that's how we're going to finish now. He said, many years ago I went to the Chazon Ish. Chazon Ish was the biggest rabbi of that generation. He said, "Rabbi, sometimes speakers, they speak in a lecture, and they have an opportunity to make up a story that never happened in life. And they know that with this story, they will wake up the hearts of the listeners to make tshuva, to see that something like this can happen in real life. It's a fiction, it's not real. But everyone will be so inspired, and they make more Jews religious. Is this allowed according to the Torah?" Or Hashem said, "No, I'm not interested. Stick to the truth, whatever happened, happened." So the Chazon Ish told him, it's needless to say. If you're allowed to be mechalel Shabbat, to save a life of a person when he's only going to live here 10, 15, 20 years and he died anyway, right? Right? Mechalel Shabbat could be Rasha, still be mechalel Shabbat to save him. To save a soul of a Jew, you hesitate if you're allowed to make up a story or not, it's needless to say. To mechalel Shabbat you're allowed to save a body. Definitely you're allowed to be mechalel Shabbat to save the body and the soul. And definitely to say a story, which is much less than being mechalel Shabbat, for sure you're allowed. So the Rav Shvadron smiled to his big audience, and he said, and that's the first story in my history that I made up. The story with the old man. Relax, it never happened. But I tell you something similar that did happen. Something very similar. A man works in a moshav in the north of Israel. He works in an apple factory for many years. You know, they make apple juice. Until today they have this place. Then, after a few years, he got a little bit older. He cannot work anymore with apples, so he became a taxi driver. One day he get a phone call, go to the airport. There's an American rich guy who came to Israel and he needs to go to a hotel in Yerushalayim. Go pick him up. So he takes his taxi, he drives to the airport, he stands over there with a sign. A rich man came out, you know, with his show, with his cigar. He takes his suitcase to the car. They drive together to Yerushalayim. The rich guy said, do you mind if I smoke? He said, no, if you smoke, I also smoke. Because he's embarrassed to smoke with his passengers. No. So he lights a cigar. And now this guy is putting a cigarette and he's looking for a match. So the older person, is the rich guy, goes like this to him with his match, with the lighter. And he light him the cigarette. By looking at his, by lighting the cigarette from his hand, he saw that he has a number from the Nazis, a Holocaust, an ID number. Holocaust. He looked at his number, he gave a shout, he screamed, wow! Wow! He made a U-turn. Now this is a real story. The other one was fiction, but this has really happened. And I even have the names written in my black book, which I forgot to bring with me today. No, the Nazi number, the Nazi made tattoos. So he make a U-turn. He made a U-turn. He was on the way to Yerushalayim. He made a U-turn and he started to drive all the way to the north. Where? To his moshav. He drive. The rich guy said, what, are you kidnapping me? What's going on? He said, please, don't talk to me until I get there. No, what is this? I called the police. We're arguing the whole way. He said, trust me, I got to show you something. Trust me, don't ask me. I have a big surprise for you. Now, the most important thing, I didn't say it. The driver is a handicap. His two legs were chopped off all the way to the knee. How did it happen? When he was working in a factory with the apples, one time, three apples got stuck where they have a lid. You close it and the machine peels the apples and then grind them and they make juice. Three apples got stuck and you cannot close the lid. And then afraid the juice is going to start flashing all over. So they try with a stick to get to the apples and he said, no, we're losing too much time. So he said, okay, let me climb like this and I'll kick it with my legs and make them fall down. As he came, he slid, it was wet a little bit. The machine down there, all the way down, was, and it's full of thousands of apples. He fell on the pile of the apple. And the machine grinds the bottom of the apple, so it keeps going down like this. And now, it's very, very slippery. There's no way. He screams, and the noise of the machine, nobody realized what happened. He fell inside. From the other side, people are standing. And he fell in and he screamed. That's it. And he started to feel his feet are grinded. And went all the way up to his knees and he grind all his legs. Up to his knees. Now they put two prothesis, fake legs. And that's how he walks. You know, they made a surgery. How did he get saved? All of a sudden he saw an arm, boom, put the machine off. One guy, Mendel, a Holocaust survivor, with a number, serial number on his arm. He say, even in my dream, he wake me up, I'll tell you the number of that old man who saved my life. Now he drives to the Moshav with this American guy. He gets to the house of this Mendel, banging on the door. 9, 10 o'clock at night. Boom, boom, boom. The old man comes out. He says, Mendel, remember you told me that the Nazis kill your brother? You never saw him. They took him away one day. Come outside, come. The American guy and Mendel, same serial number, the last digit, 7 and 8. Wow. Standing on the same line, the whole family, and they tattooed them. He saw the same serial number, one digit difference. And he took him all the way. That's a true story that happened. You understand? To say there's no Ashgacha, you gotta be blind. Every day, new stories like this, you see, with names, numbers, people. Can write hundreds of books full of miracles. Baruch Adonai l'olam, amen v'amen.